Chapter 11. The Feast.
The woods are changing, Katlyn whispered as they slipped between the massive trunks of trees. She was right, Haille thought. After following the horde for what felt like an hour, the underbrush had thinned, and the spaces between the trees had widened.
It's this, Val said, kicking at a pile of spore on the ground. It released a smell akin to cat urine and pig feces. Droppings of these monsters, he said with a nod to Storn, who led the way, hiding behind one tree, then the next. This shite must kill everything that tries to grow from the forest floor.
Storn hissed for quiet, putting his stump to his mouth and pointing upwards with an extended claw. Katlyn stifled a gasp. Just above their heads, hanging like bats from the tree branches, were more of the creatures. So close were they that Haille could see the mess of interlocking and twisted teeth, the folded conical ears, the enormous nostrils. Their eyes were closed, as if in sleep. Cody guided his sword out of his sheath. Val, Haille, and Katlyn followed suit. The trees began to have an ordered appearance. Each was equidistant from the next, and they seemed arranged in long, straight colonnades, which, in turn, formed corridors and, in places, small rooms or large chambers. The place was part forest and part fortress. Looking left and right, Haille saw the larger gray creatures, awake and moving in dim torchlight. Haille could hear their ghoulish voices as they communicated with grunts, hisses, and guttural groans. Occasionally, a howl would echo throughout the forest, reverberating between the trunks and freezing the four of them in place. Storin continued on, unperturbed, followed by the elk. There was no trust between them. The elk followed Storin closest, his rack of antlers lowered so the points hovered just behind the imp's neck. Between the howls and the grunts of the beasts, the forest was otherwise silent. Gone were the noises of other forest creatures. Everything here that was not a monster had fled or was dead. Ahead, a light appeared between trunks. Haille moved to get a better look and noticed Storn was slowing down, the hair on his back standing on end. It was firelight they saw. It grew and spread, silhouetting the trees like light from behind prison bars. Haille stepped on something that rolled under his foot. Picking it up, he realized it was too light to be stone and too heavy to be wood. It was curved like a fragment of a bowl, but not cold like porcelain. Realizing what it was, he dropped it with a shudder where it fell among a mess of other skulls, some human, some not. Cody let out a disgusted curse, while the elk made a loud huff like an angry horse. Val waved at them all to be quieter. Katlyn was unable to comply, running back behind a tree and retching. Haille stood stupidly, unsure as to move forward or go back and help Katlyn. What were they doing? Why had it felt so important to follow and save this girl? Something was pawing at him. It was Storn, poking at the severed claw and holding out his good one, empty.
You want it? Haille asked. Not yet. You have to get us out of here, too. Only then, when we are safe, do you get it.
Storn snarled, then turned away. Haille and Val followed now, with the others bringing up the rear. In the chamber ahead of them, the monsters, giant grays and impish greens, were gathered round a fallen tree turned into a table of sorts. Storn pointed around a trunk. By the way he cowered, Haille sensed this place was the center of things, the deepest recess of the creature's lair, and the worst of Storn's betrayal. Haille kept a hand to the severed claw, loath to let go of their only leverage over the imp. Before he could step forward for a better look, Val took him by the arm.
Prince, we might not all get out of this one alive, he said. Are you saying we should turn back? He said, looking into the captain's eyes. They were focused, hard as steel. No. You've chosen righteously. But sometimes the righteous can do the right thing and still lose. It is one of the hardest lessons to learn.
Haille swallowed. For a moment he felt he understood Val. his life of great idealism and great disappointment better than ever. The captain, despite his scars and his burden of loss, was the most honorable man Haille knew. Haille felt a terrible fear swell within him, not of the creatures or what fate might await them in the clearing ahead, but a fear of disappointing yet another mentor, as he had disappointed his father. He was not sure if it was admiration or love he felt for Val in that moment. Maybe it was just a misplaced desire to please his own father, but Haille knew his choice was already made. The forest shook with howling and screeching, and for a moment a whole chorus of the beast's collective voices. A great commotion roiled in the clearing. Creatures shifted and parted, and Haille saw the bloody remains of something, someone on the table. He was afraid they were too late. Then he was afraid the commotion meant they had been discovered, but none of the creatures looked in their direction. Instead, they were all turned towards the end of the chamber to Hale's left. He and Val pressed closer to the tree between them. The din of the horde was such that it drowned out any sounds they could make. Haille and Val made their way over ground littered with cracked and splintered bones. One of the jays made a somber whistle from the elk's antlers. Cody cursed. The room was larger than Haille would have guessed, longer than it was wide. Soot from the torches had turned the branches above them black, but the trunks below were stained white and brown. Bone dust and blood. Two greys carried in the girl he had seen before. She was stripped of her armor and clad only in her fabric garments, a simple tunic and breeches. Her limbs were tied to two ragged logs. The two greys dropped her on the table. The logs overlapped just behind the small of her back, bending her entire body painfully upwards, her tunic parted from her belt, the soft skin of her midriff exposed. Behind the two greys followed a tall one, his scales a dark blue-black, his head crowned with a headpiece of braided gold. This blue-black thing bent down over the girl, the horde silencing as he neared her. His teeth moved. He was speaking. She was turned away. One of the greys handed a curved sword to the blue-black creature. It was made of brownish metal, with a green patina growing on it. The blue-black thing drew his hands over the girl's face, lifting up her hair. Haille had been mistaken. She was not looking away, but directly into the eyes of the monster before her, defiant. He could see the white of her skin stained red by the rivulets of blood that trickled from her wound, and her burning blue eyes that stared unflinching into the nightmare above her. The beast's neck bent in a fluid motion, the braided golden crown shifting slightly. He moved backwards, the nails of his feet rasping on the table. His fingers tightened around the sword, and his eyes narrowed to slits. It was strange to watch the language of his body. In some ways, he was readable like any human. It was almost as if a human was dressed in a costume of the creature. Yet, in other ways, he was pure animal, an overgrown lizard, tongue flicking among his teeth, yellow eyes darting. The other creatures were already pulling at the girl's limbs, fingers wrapped around her throat. Haille realized he could not stand to see her flesh rent again. She gave a cry. The blue-black thing lifted his sword. The jays cried out in surprise as the elk leapt forward into the clearing with a deep bellow. He caught two green imps immediately on the ends of his antlers, impaled them, then flung them, their own blood spiraling outward into the trees.
"I guess we're not waiting,"
Val said, and rushed into the clearing after the elk. Haille followed, aware of Cody and even Katlyn scrambling over bones and skulls after him. Hale's fear turned to rage as he looked upon the scene before him. The helpless girl, the hideous things with their ravenous mouths. He wished for all their deaths, for their complete extinction. Two more green creatures leapt at him, but his sword was up and cleaved them into halves. Out of the corner of his eye, he saw Katlyn stab one with a yell and Cody kick another in the face before running another through. They were mad, all five of them. Warriors, butchers, and hopefully saviors. The creatures panicked, in complete pandemonium, while Haille and his companions cut them down, stabbed them in their scaly necks, and slashed at their leathery bellies. The monsters began to form ranks around the table. Haille ran forward before his path to the girl was cut off, but gasped as he was thrust aside and went tumbling. A green creature was standing on him. It scratched and bit at him wildly, ripping at his clothes. The terror of it broke him out of any controlled, practiced defense he knew, and he kicked and swung at any bit of the monster that he could. It was Katlyn who drove into its side with her short sword, knocking it off. Cody ran it through with his sword that was already dark with oily black blood. Katlyn reached down to help Haille up, but she was tackled from behind by another one of the creatures. This one pinned her to the ground with its legs and moved to rake her neck open with his claws. Haille scrambled across the ground, but it was another creature that fell upon the first and twisted him off. Storn. Their guide, or whatever he was, squared off with his own brethren before they both charged, tangling and growling like wild dogs in a fight for dominance. The elk made a second foray into the ranks lined up around the table. Some resisted, others fled. A path opened to the girl, and Haille dashed into it, leaping on the table and taking aim at the blue-black leader standing astride her. At the last moment, he sensed Hale's swing and jumped away, quick as a frog, dropping his sword to clatter on the table behind him. Haille lost his footing and fell down on the frame holding the girl. Their foreheads collided. "Quick! My hands!" she yelled. Haille scrambled for his sword, feeling clumsy and foolish. When he got to his feet, a green beast was taking a swipe at him with spread claws. A cat in an alley, grown to prodigious proportions. Haille stabbed at the thing, but missed again. The girl screamed, "My hands!" Her right hand bent upwards like some bound bird. Haille cut the bindings. She reached over, and before he could even step over her to cut her other hand loose, she was sitting upright, both hands free. Another beast jumped up to the table, and this one Haille caught solidly in the chest with his sword. He heard the girl's voice again, a tone of command. "Unvoiced!" Was she talking to him? He looked over his shoulder to see her bent over her foot, which was now free, vine bindings falling from it like untied bootlaces as she stood. The creature Haille had impaled writhed as he stepped on it and pulled the sword out with a sickening slurp. Two more came charging at him. He swung. One he cut deeply across the neck, but the other he barely caught with the point of his sword. The impact knocked Haille to his knees. Now three more came running up the table, their claws digging in, throwing up bits of rotten wood. He could hear Storn struggling with other attackers behind him. Val, Cody, and Katlyn were too far to help. This was the end. He had overreached. Then the girl jumped back between them, armed with the sword the blue-black leader had discarded. She swung and caught one attacker square on the head, another with a slice across the neck, and the third she kicked in the face. She turned to Haille. He was staring without words. She had to yell at him to turn around, where he caught another approaching beast on the end of Elkhart. He turned and, now with more confidence, caught the next attack. The three of them, Haille, the girl, and Storn, formed a triangle on the table, their backs to each other. Katlyn, Cody, and Val formed another on the floor, while the elk crashed through the monster's numbers, his antlers bloodier than any of their swords, the jays circling above and diving like darts for the eyes of the creatures. Claws reached for Hale's sword, but he hacked at them, his blade making a singing noise as the black nails went flying loose. Soon, more of the hideous things began dropping in from branches above. The clearing was filled with more monsters than there had been in the original horde. Haille guessed that the ones they had seen sleeping had now awakened and joined the fray. He was looking for a way to flee, but it was a solid sea of leather skin around them. Confusion and surprise, Haille realized, was the only reason he and the others had not been torn to shreds. Yet, the beasts had rushed at them haphazardly, with no reason or logic in their attack, but more like animals moved only by the instinct to defend and kill. But that had changed. A line of greys reformed ranks on the periphery of the chamber, and then moved to attack. A thud on the table behind Haille caused him to turn. To his horror, one of the greys had landed just behind him and was already swinging a pole axe at his head. No time to parry, Haille could only duck. Then the creature fell with a gasp. The girl had smote him. Haille went to rise, but he suddenly felt a great compression on his shoulder. The girl was standing on him. Then her weight was gone. Haille looked up, only to see another gray thing descending upon him, his wings beating furiously, his eyes fixed upon Hale's neck. But then the shape of the girl flew in front of him. Her arms jerked the sword across the beast, and his narrow eyes widened. There was a sudden rain of hot, black blood. Drops obscured Hale's vision, and he cried out. The stuff burned like acid. He knew others would see this as an opportunity to attack, so he forced his eyes open and spun around. A charging creature impaled itself on the end of Elkhart. He fended off two more before he could take a chance to wipe his eyes with his sleeve. The girl had landed at the far end of the table. Another gray was descending between them. The glance upwards burned Hale's eyes anew, but before they involuntarily clenched shut, he saw the girl rise into the air with all the grace of a dancer. Haille felt the thud of the dead thing on the table. The girl was beside him suddenly, landing without sound. He felt her touch his shoulder.
"It's the blood. I can't see."
He sensed her turn and strike something. He heard the screech of one of the monsters.
"You will have to," she said.
He listened as she spat into her hands, then pressed them to his eyes. Her saliva was hot and soothing. He forced his lids open. By now, the rhythm of the battle was in him, and he turned to catch the expected attack from behind. He spun back to her. She was kicking two beasts off Storn. Hale's left eye was fogged with tears, casting everything in a halo of light. He thought he would go blind from the burning sensation. His right eye flickered open and shut, and still the beasts came running. He forgot all training. He was swinging without thought, without technique, only to survive. The tide had shifted. Now he and his friends were those without a plan, without order. He felt as if he was running out of air. There was no relief. He killed few beasts. Mostly he mauled them horribly, and then they came charging back at him, terrible visages, mangled by his own fear and a blade he could barely control. Gaping maws, red throats, snarling voices. It was like being a piece of meat among rabid dogs. He swung, wholly sure that a creature would get past him on his blind side, or simply from straight ahead of him. This was nothing like the stories of battles he had heard of in songs. But, inexplicably, a lull came. Haille rubbed his eyes again. Some of the rings of gold about the torches disappeared, and the fluttering of his right eye slowed. He saw that the clearing was full of dead monsters, or wounded ones clambering on stumps.
What have we done?
He thought of Storn. The creature was still there on the table, cut and bleeding, but alive. So was the girl. He performed an inventory of the rest of his friends. Val and Cody were back to back, Katlyn bent over and winded between them. The elk chased a screaming green imp into the trees. But the woods were not still. They could all hear the clatter of arms and the commotion of voices. The things were regrouping. Haille knew he and his friends had to flee, now. They had no chance otherwise. The ground, the table, the trees were slippery with blood. He tried to find a spot on his hand that was not covered with the oily stuff so he could wipe his eyes once more. Val came up alongside them.
"We have to go."
The girl, unmoved by his tone of command, replied,
"Wait." "Are you mad?" Val asked. "I'm nearly blind," Haille said.
She turned her eyes on him. Her cheek wounds were bright with her own fresh blood weeping down her face and neck. Her hair was matted with the stuff.
"And you are wounded as well. We cannot last,"
Haille added, trying to add a note of pleading to his voice, but he suspected it sounded more like desperation. As if she just remembered her wound, her hand went protectively to her cheek. Her whole demeanor changed as she did so. Her shoulders slouched a bit, the blade of her sword dipped, and her eyes grew sad and doubtful. She winced as she moved her jaw, but Haille could see her pain fuse back into anger. The stature of a warrioress returned, and she shook her sword. He knew then there was no dissuading her.
"Wait,"
she said again, an unmistakable command. Haille could not refuse, but he climbed down off the table and gathered with his friends, putting an arm around Katlyn and pulling her close to his chest. The noises of the horde massed at one end of the clearing, the sound of trampling feet synchronized into a drumbeat of marching. Haille wiped his eyes, his tears narrowing his vision to a tunnel of clarity surrounded by blobs of cloudy light. He had to whip his head all about just to see what was around him. What he could see was that the gaps between the trees were dark with moving figures. Some played the part of beasts, crawling along the trunks and swinging up into the boughs. Others played the part of men, mostly the gray ones, filing in, wisdom and ken in their eyes, armed now with bows and arrows. A few shots flew by the girl's head, but for the most part the creatures restrained themselves. There was order to this attack. More grays began dropping in from above. These were fresh to the fight. Wings beat and clapped. Haille kept looking over his shoulder. A spot of clear woods he had previously eyed as their avenue of escape was growing smaller. Still the girl was standing, her sword at the ready and her legs spread wide, as if the table she stood upon was a ship rocking at sea. A change swept over the beasts. They scraped at the ground with their claws and snorted through their porcine noses. Their mouths worked open and close, their mess of teeth overlapping and interlocking at odd angles. Did the girl not realize that they were organizing a new attack? How could they afford to remain here? He looked at Val, who was sheathing his sword.
If the fool doesn't move, I'll carry her out.
Then the trees darkened, branches snapped apart, and a gargantuan nightmare came tearing into the clearing. It flailed arms wrapped in spiked iron bangles, ran on legs covered in a coat of bristling black hair, and swung a head crowned by two massive yellow horns. This thing charging, this dervish of snarling, hissing, and extended claws, was like the other creatures, but ever so much larger. Its teeth were gold, its eyes black, its skin a bright heart of the furnace red. Its wings were huge and flailing like black sails. In place of one eye, a gray scar ran down its face and into its maw of golden teeth, and it veered its head in wide arcs from left to right to take in the entire scene with its good eye. Haille felt the breeze from its wings and could smell the creature's stench, something akin to a dead cow rotting in a tar pit. It had all the mass and exaggerated size of a statue cut from stone, and its red skin looked just as impervious. But, unlike a statue, this perversion of reality, this horror come to life, could move, and with the alacrity of a raging bear, it trampled over the other beasts in its path and made straight for the girl. The other creatures' voices rose up in a ravenous chorus. Even the larger grays looked like little imps in comparison to the monstrosity. But the others held their ground. They were but spectators to this attack. The red thing clutched a whip, the end of which shone with metal studs. As Haille followed the path of the whip, he saw its ends pass over the head of the blue-black creature, the leader with the braided golden crown, newly armed with a gold scimitar. The red beast bent forward, one arm smashing the end of the table, the other swinging the whip at the girl. Like a dancer, she snapped her body in a backflip, heels overhead, landing out of reach of the whip, leaving its studs to rake the empty air. Her feet settled on the uneven table and found an animal skull which she kicked into the face of the beast. It growled and readied its whip once more. Haille realized that all that had come before in the forest, the noises, the vines, the mysterious whispering shadows, all had only been prelude to this. These monsters were the true curse of Sidon. Better they had been left undisturbed. He was no stronger than those that had built Cadre within Night's Reach. Like them, he had tempted the fates of the forests, stirred its mysteries, challenged these monsters. And now he and his friends would be punished. Then there was the girl, standing athwart the table that had been intended as the place of her dismemberment. And as improbable as it was, She was staring down the beast, which closed the distance between them in two easy steps, its whip shooting out again, its mouth gaping in a wet, golden grin, its nails hanging like curved swords. The girl did not back away, nor did she jump. This time, she ducked, as if this was all a dance, and she knew the steps beforehand. The beast coiled the whip back, gathering it in the air over its shoulder for another strike. To Haille's surprise, the girl closed in on the creature. The studded thongs changed direction and moved to meet her, but halfway, she flung her own sword end over end from above her head. She cried out with the effort, locks of her hair flying. The sword made a deep hum as it wheeled and a clang like a ruined bell as it sliced off one of the nails of the great beast. The girl's momentum flung her forward, and she landed, skidding to a stop, her arms outstretched just a finger's length from the thing's legs. Haille was sure now that she was beyond help, but the throw had been accurate, and the force deadly. The sword was lodged, handle swaying, in the remaining eye of the blinded beast. A fountain of tar was streaming forth, raining on her. The giant made no noise. At first, Haille thought it was stunned, for it stood still, its mouth open, teeth frozen in mid-gasp, claws in mid-grasp. Then, Haille realized its stillness was more than being stunned. It was dead. It dropped slowly backwards, as if it took a long time for its dead weight to build the momentum or make the decision to fall. When it did, the other creatures let out a shocked and panicked wail. They scrambled out of the way, but they had not expected the beast to fall, and there were too many of them gathered in its shadow. Many did not escape, and as it crashed down onto the forest floor, it pinned a tangled mass of beasts beneath it. The girl was running back now, dancing lightly between the gore on the table, somersaulting down to the level ground alongside Haille and the others, and breaking for a gap in the trees, the bone grit grinding under her feet as she stopped and turned to them. Now we run! Chapter 12. Flight to the Gilithwain. Storn led down pathways among the trees, loping along on his stubby legs. When Cody began to overtake the creature, he let out a curse, picked Storn up, and threw him over his shoulders. From there, Storn hissed and pointed the way, Cody gasping, "I'll be damned if this smell ever comes off me!" They ran, the noise of the horde ever at their backs. The girl followed Cody. Haille tossed her his extra dagger so she wasn't weaponless. It was none too soon, for they came across a stray green imp when they turned around the trunk of a tree. He raised his hackles, bared his teeth, and swiped at them, but the girl set upon him and opened his throat with the efficiency of a butcher long inured to the nature of slaughter. Katlyn followed close to the girl, Val and Haille behind her, the elk bringing up the rear. Occasionally, he would fall back and they would hear the clash of weapons on antlers. Screams and howls would echo through the trees. Each time, Haille waited in suspense to see if the elk would return. Each time he did, black blood running down his antlers into his face. They sprinted down a long corridor that brought to mind a castle hall, with trees taking the place of columns. The uniformity was broken where one tree lay uprooted. Storn indicated they should turn there, and they clambered over the upturned roots. Thick undergrowth waited for them on the other side, but Cody hacked through it with his sword, and they found themselves standing on a brick pathway, an ancient paved road. Grass grew in the spaces between the paving stones, and roots snaking beneath made the surface uneven. The girl was heartened. "I know where we are! This way!" she said, indicating to their right. They continued, Haille looking back over his shoulder to see the elk leaping through the brush behind them to gallop down the road, the horde breaking through like a pack of hunting dogs just behind him. The road turned, bending around blind corners, until eventually the trees to one side disappeared altogether, replaced by a long drop into a river of black water. Around another bend, the ruins of a stone bridge stretched halfway across the water. It was like the gorge in the Badlands, where Victor Twenge had waited for them, except this bridge was shattered. The girl ran right to its base and climbed the stairs up onto its walkway. Tree branches had grown down low over it, their lengths hung with the familiar choking black vines. The girl dodged between them, hacking at them when there was no way around. "Come on!" she cried, as they followed too slowly for her liking. Hale and Val, however, were of the same mind. They both waited at the base of the bridge for the elk to catch up to them. When he did, the horde was just behind. Val fought off a few of the leading imps as the elk climbed the stairs alongside them, then began to slash his own way through the branches and vines blocking their path. They came to the end of the bridge, where the stones fell away into the dark waters below, and the others stood waiting. "It's the Gilithwain," the girl said. "They can't cross it." Hale felt an unexpected rush. Where had he heard that word before? Why did he feel an association of safety along with it? There was no time to think. The girl was leaning over the edge, peering down into the water. "We'll have to jump and swim to the far bank," she said, waving her arms about Storn. "I'll spell him so he can cross." "No swimming. We'll swing," Hale said, slapping the flat of his sword into the black vines. As before, they shivered and went limp. The girl did not move to touch them, but Hale did, reaching out to grab one, drawing it back and handing it to Katlyn. "You first." She took it, pulled it back as far as it would go, set her feet while taking a deep breath, then released herself to swing. At the apogee of her path, she loosened her grip, slid down the length of the vine, and dropped with a tumble onto the opposite bank. Cody pulled a vine close for Storn next and sent him over with a shove. He landed with an unceremonious bump. A few of the vines began to jerk and curl around Val's chest while he waited. Hale slapped at them with Elkhart. "Best you go now, Captain," he said. Val nodded and swung over, the girl following close on another vine, Cody too. Hale was left staring eye to eye with the elk. Without arms, the animal would not be swinging. Instead, he backed up to make a running jump. But as he did, the horde appeared at the top of the steps, a gray reaching up to tear into his hindquarters with his claws. The elk stumbled. Hale rushed to help, swinging his sword from his shoulder in a sweep that severed the gray's forearm. But it was already too late. The other beasts had climbed the stairs, overrunning them. All they could do was swing, hew, and hack at the claws, legs, and limbs that tried to gain purchase on the steps, fighting for the high ground. The flood was too much. The two of them could not withstand the onslaught. Hale heard movement above and looked up to see a figure bounce through the branches only to land behind him. He turned and caught the swipe of claws just as the blue-black leader of the beasts attacked. Hale pivoted towards the elk to close his flank while the blue-black thing raised his scimitar for a cross strike. The blow was like catching a landslide. Hale stumbled back into the elk and would have lost his footing had not the elk turned and nudged him with a grunt. Hale raised his sword to block another strike from the leader, this crowned king of the monsters, then another. The blows came too fast for him to do anything but block and dodge. There was no counterattack. This beast was too good. He fought with the reflexes of an animal and the skill of a master swordsman. In his eyes, Hale could read a fierce intelligence, as well as a burning hate, directed at him, the elk, and his friends. Hale knew when he was overmatched, and he gave ground, backing up towards the broken end of the bridge, bracing himself against his opponent's attacks. The melee between the elk and the horde continued behind the king as he stalked Hale, moving in long, careful strides with his bowed, lizard-like legs. Hale brushed up against one of the vines, felt it twitch, and realized he had a new problem. No sooner had he sidled away from the awakening vine when the king came at him. Hale mounted no defense. Instead, he rolled beneath the oncoming swing and listened as the sheaf of vines dropped to the floor in the wake of the scimitar. They flopped about onto the stonework, squirming like snakes. A green imp slipped past the elk, and Hale had just time to swing his blade into its face before the king was on him again. Hale knew he was lost, for his guard was down and the king's arm was cocked back ready to strike. The swing did not come. Instead, the king of the beast's eyes bulged and his body jerked as the muscles across his chest flexed. The vines had seized his sword arm. Not willing to let his opportunity pass, Haille found the angle on the trapped arm and swung for the wrist. His opponent proved too fast again, twisting his arm and seizing Hale's own wrist in a crushing grip. He lifted a leg to trap Haille under his foot, but as he moved, the vines rescued Haille once more, wrapping around the king's torso and neck. Now his attacker turned to swipe at the vines, threatening to strangle him. Having lifted one foot, he lost balance and toppled over, more vines swirling and encircling him. Haille knew he had been granted a reprieve, and instead of closing in for an uncertain death strike, he called to the elk.
"We need to go, now!"
The elk tossed one of the imps from his antlers into the wall of attackers, sending them all falling backwards down the stairs. Then he turned and began galloping towards Haille. In that instance, Haille understood the shared plan. There was little other choice. He sheathed his sword, glancing over his shoulder one last time. As he did, something in the blue-black monster's shoulder popped. The leathery skin tore, and vines writhed into the gap that opened between arm and shoulder. Haille looked back to the elk, who was approaching at a full gallop. He would only have one chance, and as the elk passed alongside him, his head low, Haille took hold of his mane, threw a leg over his back, and pressed his body against the animal as he jumped into the empty air beyond the bridge. They landed with a clatter of hooves on the far bank. Haille lost his handholds and slammed into the ground, sliding through leaves and loam, his breath knocked clear out of him. His vision grew dim at the edges before he started to gulp down breaths of air. He was startled to look up and see his friends laying side by side on the ground, their faces slack and eyes closed as if in slumber. Even Storn was hunched over, his head drooping into his chest like a passed-out drunk. The elk came alongside Haille and helped him up.
"Val, Cody, Katlyn," Haille said.
But no one responded. No one moved. The girl was striding towards him, unaffected by whatever spell had overtaken his friends.
"What is wrong with them? What happened?"
The girl did not answer. Instead, she raised her hand and uttered a single word.
"Sleep."
Hale's vision flooded with white light before going completely dark. Chapter 13. King Talamar. Gale spun in close to the squire, ducking his swing, letting her momentum carry her legs into his. She fell. To some, it might have looked like she had lost her footing, but it was by design. Her legs, tangled with Kevin the squire's, threw him off balance and caused him to tumble over. His overextended swing worked against him. Gale landed painfully on her hip, but it was worth the pain to bring Kevin down. She pivoted, scissoring her legs as if running, came to a half-kneeling, half-standing position, the point of her sword pointed downward at Kevin's neck.
"I yield," he said, shamefaced.
There was a scattering of applause from the edges of the ring, the most fervent of which came from Patrick, the other squire she had just bested, who now had company in defeat. She considered the two squires. In every way, Patrick was Kevin's opposite. Tall and fair where Kevin was dark and stocky. Patrick was careful, meticulous, and measured in his methods of attack. Kevin charged like an angry bull. But she had had the best of both of them. And perhaps their grudging respect, too. Darrett had kept her secret in the weeks that had passed, but her size had not won her many believers. It was only when she had the opportunity to fight in the practice ring that the soldiers and squires began to learn her name, Alex, and stop calling her Horse Boy, as Sergeant Callum had named her. Not that he had made any effort to change himself.
"Nice work, Horse Boy," he said from the edge of the fighting square. "Call us when you are full-sized, and we'll have a rematch."
There was laughter, Gale wondering if it was directed at her or Callum himself, who would wear the scar she gave him for the rest of his days. He had surely concocted some story of heroic high adventure to explain it, but she suspected most of the regiment knew the true story. Gale reached out a hand to help Kevin up. He took it. It was late, the sun setting and lighting the sandstone buttes and arid steps to the east blood red. They had marched just shy of 2 weeks, and here in the borderlands between Kareth and Antos was the first time they had stopped for more than 3 nights, while scouts sought out the lay of the land and the position of the enemy forces. The men were bored, restless, and likely scared, although they covered it with bluster and an outward eagerness for battle. Too eager, Gale thought. Fights had broken out among men of rival houses, and nobles were squabbling with knights over who got to sit closer to the king at mealtimes. Kevin and Patrick told her all about it. Setting up fighting rings for the men to expend their extra energy had been Darrett's idea, and a good one.
"That is the first match I have lost in a long time," Kevin said, dusting off his breeches. "Who had the best of you last time?" Patrick asked, handing his friend a waterskin. "The king's son himself," Kevin said between gulps. "He's undersized like you, Alex, but quick as a bat."
"I thought he was an imbecile," she said, handing her practice sword to the next squire to take the ring.
"He suffers from the shaking sickness," Kevin said, giving away his own sword and clearing the ring for the next pair. "But he can fight."
"The shaking sickness," she said, her voice trailing off. Seemed it was a more common malady than she had imagined, having just run across Derek and his condition. Not a bad swordsman himself, come to think of it. They made their way along the main avenue of the tent city that was the camp, the air redolent with the smell of roasting meat, horse manure, and the smoke of 1,000 campfires. The clack of practice swords, and even real ones, accompanied by the eruption of cheers or jeers, followed them all the way back to the noble's compound, that circle of tents in the heart of the camp, where the king's court was held and their master's tents were pitched. She said farewell to her friends and parted ways, knowing that both young men would be required to wait on their lords for the dinner hour. It was a secret Gale kept closely guarded that Darrett did not expect much from her. He preferred camaraderie to servitude, and they often ate at the camp table as equals. From the way he driveled on about an ebony-skinned woman with wavy hair waiting for him in Kareth, she never suspected Darrett of wanting anything more from herself than friendship. She stepped around the fire pit. Soot caught at her from the peak of the tent. It was no surprise to her that Darrett himself had already set a cauldron of boiling vegetables and beans, as well as a chicken carcass, over the fire. She reached in, pulled out a stewed carrot, and threw it to Soot. Her stomach grumbled as she caught a whiff of the stew before she put the top back on, then snapped back the flap and stepped into the dim light of the tent interior. What she saw caused her to stop short and bite her tongue, silencing the casual greeting she had been about to blurt out to her master. Darrett was seated with his back to her, in the very seat she was accustomed to using. Across the camp table from him sat a man who even in his chair gave the impression of being tall. His hands rested on either arm of the chair, and his purple cloak with blue border was tossed over the back. The seal on his surcoat was a hammer crossed over a sword. His hair was black, but for gray at the temples, that shone in the light drifting in from above. His face was freshly shorn, but was still full of furrows and shadows, as if he were a man of deep worries and old sorrows. He was still, but for his eyes, which darted to Gale as she entered unannounced. Darrett's chair groaned as he turned.
"Alex, take a knee for the king."
Her throat caught and her knee smarted as she crashed down to genuflect, her chin on her chest, her eyes to the floor.
"My liege," she said,
her hands trembling, outlaw that she was, in the presence of the living law himself.
"I will take my leave."
"No,"
Darrett said.
"Fetch us some goblets and wine, Alex."
Gale obeyed. She obeyed as she had never obeyed her own father, pulling the goblets from their traveling trunk, uncorking the wine, and pouring the cups half full and filling the rest with drinking water. Her hands shook. She was untrained to serve royalty. Darrett did not even require her to serve him. As if he sensed her uncertainty, Darrett motioned for her to simply set the cups on the table. Then she stood back into the shadows, as she had seen other servants do, at her own father's manor, wishing herself invisible. The two men continued their discussion as if she were not there.
The scouts report to me that the countryside has been raided and ransacked. The tribe of barbarians, the Morvent they call themselves, have murdered women, children, and warriors. Until now, they kept peacefully to the steppes. Why the attack now is still a mystery. They have taken no holdfasts, nor do they set up lines to demark their territory. Instead, they strike at random. The people are frightened and have fled to the refuge of the city walls. Now the bread lines are long, streets are choked with people, and gutters are overflowing. The city bursts at the seams. King Oeon must keep his forces around the city to protect all of the refugees that have flocked there.
Things have grown worse since I left, Darrett said,
which is why I know my own mind and wished to share it with you before the court. I will make a show of deliberating, but we must push forward before the sun sets again.
Understood. But, sire, why not give the order now?
I am giving it. You will discreetly share it with the other captains of the regular troops. I will let the nobles debate it. It is what they are best at, a necessary step. They will choose to move forward once every man has spoken his piece and each man's pride is satisfied. It is the illusion of compromise and contribution while not losing time on our part.
Well played.
It's not that I do not have reservations. We do not know the Morvan's numbers, their locations, or why they have turned on us now after so many long years of proximity and coexistence. But I fear the people of Kerith have waited too long, and our own men are restless.
Both sentiments rang true to Gale. However, something did not sit right with her. Something so straightforward, she was vexed that neither Darrod nor the king mentioned it. She curled her toes and pressed her lips together. Sweat pooled in her armpits, and she felt a bead escape and run down her side. The tactics of the Morvend were familiar to her. They were her own, from her previous incarnation as Avenger Red. But who was she to speak out of place among a captain and a king? They would know better than she. They had to. She remained silent as the men continued. When discussions concerning the enemy were concluded, Darrett asked news of the king's son.
Still no word. Missing now since before we left, but I trust Yana to find him.
Ill times for a prince to go missing.
No doubt. But do not mention it, lest nobles start to talk of conspiracies. That goes for your squire, too, the king said, nodding at Gale.
Don't worry, Darrett said. Alex is good at keeping secrets.
Chapter 14. Gandolin and Seraphina. Hale woke, rubbed his eyes, and listened to the familiar chirps of the jays. With relief, he realized he could see clearly, the pain in his eyes gone. He was laying on his back, looking up into a glass dome overhead. The support beams were not cut and measured planks, but rather the irregular twisting of tree roots, trained like vines on a terrace, into a shape that held the glass above. Beyond the dome rose the majestic trunks of the Sidon trees, but, unlike the cursed black trunks he had become accustomed to, these were a more ordinary red-brown, topped with boughs of green needles and clusters of fat pine cones, dripping with crystallized sap. The smell of pine was overwhelming and refreshing. Hale propped himself up on his elbow and saw his friends lying asleep on either side of him. They were not alone. Two figures stood before them, a man and a woman. He was dressed in the colors of the forest overhead, shades of green in his robe, and a tunic that was red-brown beneath, all of it cinched by a braided leather belt at his waist. On his left was a woman, she in the darker colors of the forest they knew already, a sash of deep red, a black robe with a twilight purple border. Earrings and a matching necklace dangled like silver teardrops. Her face was benign, friendly even. Their ages were hard to guess. Both had white hair and deep lines radiated from their eyes and framed the corners of their mouths, yet there was a puckish quality to both of them. Haille immediately warmed to both of them, and as he stood up, he noticed a third figure. The girl they had rescued stood just to the side of them. She was in fresh clothes, a black velvet skirt and a flowing white top, a thick belt hanging askew on her hips, and a broad sword resting in its sheath. Her hair was pulled back, and her face was bandaged where Storn had wounded her. Storn was not there among his friends, Haille realized, but the elk was, drinking from a pool filled by a tiny waterfall coursing over a sharp ledge. He could see fish darting and playing in the water, gobbling up the drops that fell from the elk's chin. Sunlight dappled down through the network of tree roots and cast the space in an amber glow. Everything bespoke peace and serenity, from the falling water to the jay's song to the wind he could hear in the trees above. Haille, even though with strangers, felt safe. His friends started to wake. Like he, they scanned the room and rose to their feet.
"Welcome, and our thanks to you," the strange man said, spreading his arms wide before clasping his hands together over his heart. "For you have rescued one of our own, Violin Crossborn," he said, nodding towards the girl. "I am in your debt," the girl he had called Violin said. "This is Gandolin," the woman said, gesturing to the man who had spoken. "I am Seraphina. We are elders here." "Where exactly is here?" Val asked. The man and woman exchanged knowing glances. "There is much to explain. Forgive us, for we have not had human visitors in a generation," the man said. "Human?" Val repeated the word carefully. Haille studied the three figures before him once more, searching for something out of place. He and his friends certainly had had their share of non-human creatures, but for all appearances, these people seemed normal. Perhaps their faces were a bit long and almost otherworldly in their beauty, but nothing so terribly out of the ordinary that Haille was alarmed. Then the girl, Violin, moved her hand to draw a stray wisp of hair back behind her ear, an ear that stood pointed. Katlyn noticed at the same time. "By the stars, they are elves," she blurted. Haille felt Val and Cody draw Katlyn closer to them. "If these woods are not full of monsters and myths," Val said.
"We are no myths, I assure you," Violin said, an edge to her voice. "We are just as real as the Vorgs that we escaped from."
"Vorgs? Well, that seems like a fitting moniker," Cody said, testing the word.
"What did you do to us? How did you get us here?" Val asked.
"I cast a spell of sleep on you. I'm sorry, but I had to once we were safe. Our home here is a secret, and I could not risk you knowing the way."
"But the Vorgs, as you call them, why didn't they catch up with us?"
"They cannot cross the Gilithwain. Our people's power is too strong on this side of the river." "You are still in danger, as you will be, as long as you are on this side of the Gilithwain River." Where had Haille heard that?
"So where does that leave us? Are we your prisoners?" Val asked. "You are our guests, but that does not necessarily mean we know what to do with you. And we have yet to hear from all in your party," the man said.
Haille was sure Gandolin meant Storn. He reached down to find the claw of the beast missing from his belt. He would not miss it, but he did feel some debt to Storn. His mind raced with thoughts, explanations for how they had come across the wounded creature, even allied with him. All felt awkward seeing how he had been the same imp to wound Violin. Absorbed in his thinking, Haille took little notice of the elk stepping alongside them, his chin still dripping from the pool, the jays perched in his antlers. When his mouth moved and Haille heard a voice, he looked about the room for the speaker, unable to resolve the contradiction that presented itself to his eyes and ears. The elk. The elk was speaking. Again he felt his friends draw close to one another. Katlyn gasped. Haille stood in dumbfounded silence, his jaw slack.
"I can vouch for my companions. They are honorable and good-hearted," the elk was saying.
If I haven't lived to see extraordinary things, Cody said.
And how may we address you, of the Stygorn, I presume?
Gendolin said, his face empty of the surprise Haille and his friends were feeling.
My name is Adamantus.
It has a name, Cody said.
He has a name, Katlyn corrected. And it was your voice I heard in the carnival tent. You asked me to help you.
I heard it too, and it was you in the forest who told me to use my sword on the vines, Haille added. Both true,
Adamantus said.
But why not speak until now? Val asked.
Secrecy brings safety,
Gandalin answered for the elk.
But how did you come to be here on this continent, so far from your home? Men of the Servior took me from my place of hiding. A storm later provided me escape. The Servior's ship was lost, and I swam to shore, but I was weary, easy prey for trappers. I was traded amongst owners, until these youths found me in a carnival and released me. I am in their debt. In serving that debt, I learned that the same Servior who had interest in me had interest in them. So our lots were cast together. I have still to learn fate's final plan, but I know their quest has become my own.
It is grand company you keep, Gandalin said. And a powerful ally, Seraphina added.
Apparently,
Val said, swallowing.
So, what is this quest?
Seraphina asked. The elk answered. He had listened and listened well. Adamantus told their story from the night they had escaped from the carnival, but he had pieced together more than that, including Haille's identity and what led him to the Font of Jasmine in the first place. In a few minutes, the elk relayed their journey to Morbright, the font, and back to the castle, his mother's grave, and their discussion with Yana. Her words when she had met him, "He will reveal himself in time," made better sense to Haille now. How had Yana known? Haille, Val, and Katlyn filled in gaps in turn, but there were few. When they explained that their fears for Hale's father's safety rested upon nothing but an old woman's dreams, the elves betrayed neither skepticism nor judgment. They only nodded, as such a notion was as natural as clouds heralding rain. By the way the elk spoke of the vision, it seemed as bedrock a reason as any. Which begged the question Val asked next.
We have revealed much to you now. You know our intentions. The way has been difficult for us. Will you help us in our quest? Will you help us to the southern borders of these woods?
You have shared much in good faith to us, Gandalin said, but we cannot promise yet. We must consult with the other elders. It has been long since we have had your kind here, and never a descendant of Hillary Hillbourne, he said,
looking at Haille, the corners of his mouth drawing down in a frown.
What does my ancestry matter? Haille asked. You can be forgiven for your ignorance, Seraphina said, but that might not absolve you. You should know the truth. Hillary Hillbourne was once a friend of our people, but then, after arriving with his band of refugees from the south, he proceeded to persecute us.
Persecute, Haille said. The blood of many innocents stain his hands and soul,
Velen sneered. Haille felt unsteady, as if the flagstones beneath him were tipping like the deck of a ship at sea.
He knew magic existed, didn't he? Katlyn said. That was why he banned it. Banned books, belief, and practice. He wanted it for himself.
When founding a kingdom out of nothing, it can help to have powers of the other world. But he held on to those powers in secret and was threatened by anyone else who might use them, Gandalin said.
He was a practitioner of magic, Haille asked.
Indeed. We taught him, Gandalin said.
Haille noticed Katlyn rubbing the bracelet on her arm through her shirt sleeve, the magic bracelet that grew with her, the dragon engraved upon it. He remembered the magic of the font that had saved her from her mortal wound,
and the fire that had flickered from Sade's fingers, the fire Haille himself had forced his will upon in the instants he needed to. Orin's protendus filgrant auroras.
"Prince Haille?" Velen asked.
Haille came to himself.
"I'm sorry. It's a great deal to take in."
"It is. We bid you rest now," Seraphina said.
"Eat. The long night is over.
Grant us your patience. We will have an answer for you, this time tomorrow."
Chapter 15. In the Home of Sandalin Blythewood. Gandolin, Seraphina, and Violin left by a passageway on the far side of the chamber. Haille was wondering what they were to do next when a fourth elf emerged from the same passage. He was lean like the others, with long golden hair fashioned into a thick braid that hung midway down his back. Like Gandolin, he was dressed in the colors of the forest, greens and tawny red-browns. His face was open and inviting as he crossed the room and made an individual bow to each of them.
"I am Sandalin Blythewood. The elders have asked me to see to your needs. If you please, you can follow me, and we will make sure you are well fed."
"Happy to,"
Cody said, patting his stomach. Sandalin gestured for them to turn. Behind them stood a set of double doors carved out of bright, blonde wood. The relief on their panels depicted sun, moon, and stars cycling over a forest of slender, elegant trees. Sandalin put his hand to the doors, but before opening them, he spoke.
"You are the first visitors in a long while. Please, excuse the curiosity of our people."
None of them knew what to say, but he must have taken their silence as understanding, for he gave the doors a push. They parted to reveal a crowd of elves, old, young, and in between, some wearing the same green and browns, others draped in brighter colors, vermilion, lavenders, and primrose. As the doors spread, so did the crowd, creating a pathway through, down which Sandalin led them as if by formal procession. Curiosity dominated both sides, Haille and the others staring at the crowd that studied them back. He noted smiling faces, others wary, still others frozen in disbelief. The children, like the adults, displayed all variety. Some cowered behind their parents' legs, others leaned outward and stretched tentative fingers to touch their garments or their hands. Katlyn shook the hand of one child, and immediately more hands reached out for her. When she was on the verge of being overwhelmed, Sandalin stepped between her and the crowd and in a gentle voice said,
"There will be time enough for visiting. Our guests must recover their strength and rest."
Haille offered a few sheepish waves, but he was lost as to how to conduct himself. The distant, cold formality of royalty did not feel appropriate, especially if his own ancestor had betrayed these people. How he wanted to talk to Katlyn. She had been right. There had been something wrong all along, secrets meant to be hidden in those occult sections of the library. But he knew he would have to wait. Sandalin led them up a set of stone stairs into a plaza of covered booths, their canvases as brilliant and varied as the elves' dress. Elves milled about with baskets, boxes, and wheelbarrows. Their worlds were different, but Haille knew a market when he saw one. Sandalin led them around the edge, and even in that cursory walk, Haille glimpsed fruits and tubers for sale that were familiar yet strange. Other booths traded in powders and dyes of hues he had never seen. One offered cups of an amber drink, and the very sight of it reminded him how long it had been since he had had a decent drink of water, or anything for that matter. Not unlike the realm of the Vorgs, the contours of the elves' domain were determined by trees, lines of trunks that demarcated boundaries between plazas, chambers, and walkways. Except here, the forest was neither oppressive nor dark. Sunlight filtered down through a canopy of needles and leaves. The wind whispered in a welcome voice, a great contrast to the cacophonous din of the dark forest. As intriguing as it all was, Haille was glad to move away from the market to the smaller, more private plaza, separated by a set of curving stone stairs. This plaza, too, was paved in smooth gray stones, green with moss that the elk's hooves clicked across. A table awaited them, set with platters of bread, fruits, and sweating pitchers of the same amber juice Haille had seen in the market. The table sat in the shade of a serpentine stone wall, carved in stunning detail. On these panels, a woman did battle with a series of fell-looking opponents, mostly men, but one woman. Haille thought it notable, for all of the figures appeared to be humans, not elves. He wanted to ask more, especially about the woman who was carved in heroic proportions and with stunning features, but Sandalin was deep into explaining the offerings on the table.
"Bread, fresh from our granaries. It might not exactly be what you are accustomed to, but enjoyable still, I hope. We have jams and jellies, yams that will taste familiar to you even if they are purple and not orange, and I'd encourage you to drink the pine nectar. It will quench the most stubborn thirst."
Val thanked him for all of them. Cody was already taking bites of the offered bread. Katlyn poured herself a cup of pine nectar and sipped it.
"It's a bit like pine tea, but sweeter. It's delightful," she added, pouring a goblet for Haille.
Val offered his cup, but the captain's eyes remained on Sandalin's receding figure as he stepped over a channel of flowing water and descended the steps. As in the chamber where they had awoken, water coursed around the edges of the space, dropping over small falls. The jays fluttered in the shallow water, throwing up dazzling fans of droplets. When Sandalin was gone, Val turned to the elk.
"I dare say you have some explaining to do, elk. Or should I say, adamantus?"
"In time. This may not be the most opportune place," the elk said, glancing in the direction of the steps where Sandalin had disappeared. "The forest has ears."
"And elk voices and elves' food. Our hosts are generous," Cody said, changing the subject.
"I wonder to what extent we are truly guests or prisoners," Val said, spreading jam on some of the flatbread left out for them. "It seems all will be decided by tomorrow," Adamantus said.
"That does not mean we can't keep an eye peeled for ways out of here in the meantime," Val said. "That goes for all of you."
He swept a finger across the table at all of them.
"Prince Haille, do I have your attention?"
Haille snapped his head up. He had been thinking of Violin, the way her hips tapered to her waist and that blue fire in her eyes.
"Yes, yes, sir."
Sandalin reappeared when they had finished and offered them his own house to rest in for the day.
"It will keep you away from curious onlookers, save for my own children, but otherwise you will find rest and privacy."
Val accepted on their behalf, but not before he met Adamantus' gaze, and the elk offered a small nod. They got up slowly from the table, Haille only belatedly realizing how tired and stiff he was. Sandalin led them on a short walk over paths of pine needles, crushed by the passage of many feet. At times, it felt as if they were simply on a walk through a deep forest, except occasionally the path would open to a clearing, where water splashed in the fountain and children, elflings, Sandalin called them, played. In other clearings, grass grew knee-high and ponies were corralled. At one point, the path crossed right through the base of a massive tree. The inside was cool, the walls blonde and smooth to the touch. Upon emerging on the far side, they found themselves in a grassy yard ringed by bobbing wildflowers. At first, Haille noticed no structure until a door swung open on the tree across the meadow. This tree was even larger than the one they had passed through, and carved out of its bole was a house, with three stories of rooms, windows, even a chimney out the side that puffed clouds of white smoke. A comely woman, or rather she-elf, as Sandalin explained, with hair the color of mahogany wood and an apron around her waist, met them at the door. Two elflings, a girl and boy the likeness of both their parents, peered from behind her. Sandalin introduced his wife, Mayleaf, and his offspring, Gavin, his son, and Roslyn, his daughter. More cups of pine nectar waited on the table inside the hollowed-out room that was the kitchen. Val and Cody made polite conversation with Mayleaf, while Sandalin showed Haille and Katlyn to their rooms. They were across the hall from one another, and once Sandalin had left to tend to Val and Cody, Haille crossed the corridor. There was so much he wanted to speak to Katlyn about, but when he knocked at her door, there was no answer. He dared to open it a crack, and caught sight of her face down on the bed, snoring softly. "It has been a long road." He returned to his room, marveling at the construction, the thoroughness of the tunneling, and the novelty of being in a living house. He was admiring the window when there was a flash of blue followed by a tap-tap-tap. He turned down the latch and pushed the pane open so that Cyan could flutter in. The jay made a circuit of the room, tweeting a sharp little melody, and alighted briefly on Hill's outstretched hand before returning to the sill, where he hopped in an impatient circle, then fluttered away again. Haille knew the jays well enough to recognize when he was supposed to follow. Val's question came back to him. Were they guests or prisoners? He still did not know himself, and imagined it might have some bearing on his freedom of movement. He caught sight of Cyan again, waiting on a mossy branch a stone's throw away from the window. Perhaps ignorance could be his cover. He pushed open the second pane, threw his leg over the sill, and stepped out into the bed of pine needles that covered the ground. Smoke drifted out of the stovepipe chimney built into the side of the tree. Haille could still hear Val, Cody, and Mayleaf's voices from an open window a few steps away. Cyan dipped down from his branch and disappeared into a break in the trees. With a quick glance over his shoulder to make sure he was not spotted, Haille hastened across the clearing and into the trees. Sapphire whistled at him from farther down the path. The boughs to either side of him sparkled with amber sap crystals. The wind pulsed overhead, moving the tops of the trees and creating a constant swelling of sound that reminded Haille of the ocean. He came close to Sapphire, only to have the jay leap off her branch and shoot down the tunnel of green. Haille rounded a bend and came upon Azure next. The birds continued to leapfrog one another in such fashion, leading Haille farther down the path and into the forest. The trees changed around him. The boughs grew thicker. These trees appeared even older, as the beards of moss that hung from the branches were longer, and at some points reached the ground. The jays continued to dip and weave as the trail switchbacked down a rocky hillside. Haille clambered over outcroppings and slipped between narrow crevices. Eventually, the jays grew quiet and led in closer intervals, all three appearing together now, leading Haille to believe he was close to whatever it was they wanted him to see. They gathered, hopping on a flat stone that overlooked a drop into a lower section of the forest. By instinct, Haille stretched out flat and crawled to the edge on his belly. He could hear water falling somewhere close, and just below him was a clearing perched on the cliffside, where half a dozen figures in robes stood equidistant from one another. They formed a semicircle about a fire burning in a brazier that rested upon a stone carved with glyphs and runes. The figures were motionless until Haille saw a rusted iron gate swing open and six more figures in similar dark robes filed out. They were identical to the first group, except in the center of the line, stout and stumbling and generally ungraceful, was Storn. He looked as he had before, though perhaps after seeing the fair countenances of the elves, his smashed face, overlapping teeth, and beady eyes were even more repulsive. Yet there was a naked fear, a vulnerability that even the hideousness of his features could not hide. He cradled his severed stump, wrapped in linen bandages to his chest. He had to take three or four steps for every one that those escorting him did, so he was hunched over and breathing hard when they came to the stone and burning fire. The orange light fell on faces that Haille knew to be those of elves, but there were none he recognized. Two tended to the fire, heaping on more wood and stoking the coals, a flurry of sparks dancing in an updraft. Storn was looking left to right, likely as ignorant of the ceremony unfolding around him as Haille was. The two elves closest to the fire withdrew to their places, the flames higher now, the cracks and pops audible, even over the constant breeze in the trees. Another figure stepped forward. This one removed her hood, and Haille recognized Violin. Even with her face half covered with bandages, he knew the contours of her profile. Haille moved forward on the rock ledge, grit and lichen flakes grinding beneath him. Violin moved the folds of her robes to produce a wooden box, which she set at Storn's feet. It was made of redwood, the panels smoothed to a shine. Her motions were quick and perfunctory, as if not a moment was to be wasted, or rather, not a moment to be prolonged in proximity to the Vorg. She turned, gravel shifting under her feet. Her blue eyes flashed in Haille's direction, and he willed himself lower into the stone, wishing he were invisible. If she saw him, she showed no sign. Instead, she returned to her place in the circle and turned her back to Haille. He heard a voice, not Violin's, but one of the elves.
"Open it."
It was unmistakably a tone of command meant for Storn. Storn crept forward and reached out with his remaining hand. The box was made for soft elven hands with fleshy fingers, not the unforgiving claws of a Vorg. Storn struggled to find a grip, his long nails slipping and scraping against the box before catching on the lid and opening it. His eyes widened and he leaned over whatever was inside. With a glance upwards, as if beseeching the watching elves for permission and receiving it, he reached into the box and removed his own severed hand. It was withered and blackened, rot setting in, yet he held it to his chest like a child might a kitten or puppy. He even toyed with the limp, unmoving claws. He stepped back from the box with another glance at the elves. It was Violin who raised a hand toward the fire in the brazier.
"Burn it," she said.
Storn shifted his weight from one foot to another, his good hand flexing around the severed one before straightening his back, stepping forward, and extending his reach towards the brazier. He was too short to reach it, but his feet found easy holds on the stone so that he climbed the corner, thrust his arm deep into the fire as if his scaly skin were impervious to the heat, and released his severed hand. It sat on the coals, a black silhouette, the edges smoking, the nails cracking, until the flesh itself took light and yellow tongues of fire leapt forth. Storn was motionless while the limb withered, the skin peeling and curling like leaves that lifted up and drifted into the clouds of smoke and disappeared. When there was little left of the hand but crumbling red-hot bones that merged seamlessly with the coals, Storn broke out of his stillness and looked around. The ceremony over, the elves that had led him out turned back to the gate and the darkness beyond it. Storn followed them inside, the last of the six closing the gate after him. The other elves were already filing away toward some entrance below Haille. He studied their shapes from above, trying hard to distinguish Violin's figure, but each floated with the same grace and soft footfalls that he imagined her to move with. It was only when he caught a flash of blue over a wall of white bandages that he felt a trilling in his chest and knew he had picked her out from the others. An unseen gate clanged closed below. He waited a few beats before rising on the tips of his fingers and easing himself back from the ledge. The elk, Adamantus, was waiting for him when he turned. His coat was brushed clean of the blood of the Vorgs, and his antlers shone like newly polished blades. His head was lowered as if ready to take a mouthful of grass, but his lips were still, and his eyes turned upwards, studying Haille beneath a furrowed brow. So many times Haille had thought the elk's face was human in its expressions. He realized now these were true emotions all along. He sensed no reproach towards him for his eavesdropping, but the elk did look curious. This was the first time Haille had been alone with Adamantus. How did one speak with an animal? When an answer did not come to mind, Haille remained quiet, staring. It was the jays, tweeting and whistling, that finally broke the stillness between them.
"They are loyal to you. You've tamed them well,"
the elk said,
in his baritone voice that sounded as if it reverberated through a barrel before coming out his mouth.
"I killed their mother."
Hale surprised himself at the admission, but then again he was surprised to be speaking to an elk. Perhaps it was important to speak only the truth to enchanted animals. The elk turned his head and looked at him out of the corner of his eye as Azure hopped through his antlers. Hale continued,
"It was the day I learned my own mother was dead. Until that day, I had just thought she was on a long journey and would come back somehow. I should have known by then, but I didn't. Perhaps I didn't want to. It was some children at school who told me, teased me, for having killed my mother in childbirth. I ran out into the forest, crying, and while I was there, this blue jay started diving at my head. I struck her. It was a lucky or unlucky strike. She tumbled to the ground, stunned. Before I knew it, I had crushed her with my hands and feet. There was no blood, just a cracking noise. Her bones made a snapping sound, like crushing a wicker basket." He picked up a pine cone and tossed it over the edge. "But right after I did it, I came to myself. I heard this mad tweeting nearby. It led me to the nest of these little ones. They were just fledglings. I felt awful for what I had done. I had just killed another mother. What self-worth I had left was gone."
He shrugged and let Sapphire land on his finger, where she began to preen herself. "Raising them was my way to try to earn it back. Insufficient, I know. But what else could I do?" The elk faced him, Azure fluttering away and Cyan taking her place in his antlers, blue jewels moving through a silver crown.
"There is more to you than is apparent at first glance, Prince Hale," he said. "Mainly that I'm cruel." "And compassionate. It was compassion that moved you to befriend the Vorg, to save Violin."
Hale stood and stretched. "That was just as much anger. I was outraged. But it was also something else." Hale felt himself reaching for something that seemed just on the edge of memory, some imperative, but the harder he tried to remember it, the more it receded. He shook his head. He had lost it.
"Perhaps we should be getting back. The elves might not be pleased to have either of us wandering about," Adamantus said.
Hale agreed and retraced his steps up the hill. He liked the elk for some reason, finding him good company and free of judgment. He also felt that the elves bore a certain respect for him and an understanding Hale did not share. But he was uncomfortable asking too direct a question of the elk, such as where he was from, how he came to speak. Perhaps in time. Instead, he asked,
"What will happen to Storne?" "He can't go back. He certainly can't wander freely here either. They have him below ground in darkness. It is what he is accustomed to."
"A prisoner or a guest?"
"That remains to be determined."
"For us all."